Ladies and gentlemen, our next event of the evening is a one-fall match with a 60-minute time limit.
Hello everyone, you're listening to Where the Big Boys Play. I'm here with Chad. How are you, Chad?
Doing pretty good. I've already warned Parv that I was up late last night, so just a disclosure that I may sound a little groggy today, but I'm going to give it my best.
So what were you doing? I got a message from at like 7 a.m. my time saying, you know, and we were scheduled, I think, to start recording at 1. And you sent me a message saying that you'd gone out to a concert and only just got back. So how many hours sleep are you going on, Chad?
About 4.5 hours. Yesterday was kind of one of them crazy days where I originally didn't think anything was going to happen and then ended up going to the concert, eating some supper afterwards. So it was just a lot of unexpected stuff happening. A lot of fun, though.
See anything good?
Yeah, it's probably a band that most people would hate, but I enjoyed them. It's kind of like a jam band. I don't know if you're familiar with them.
A jam band, did you say?
Yeah.
Yeah, I kind of know what you mean.
Okay.
How was your Christmas?
It was pretty good. Didn't do a lot. This is the first Christmas that me and my wife have shared in our house, so that was nice that we were able to decorate our house. How was yours? I know you said you celebrate that also.
Yeah, we I spent it at my wife's place, and there won't be any Dusty Rhodes weight jokes for me this week because I probably put on 10 pounds or something. I've done a lot of eating. I've just sat in that. I probably ate about 6 blocks of cheese, God knows how much turkey, etc. So I'm pretty bloated at this point. In fact, I got a wrestling related gift. I got the WWF video review book that was posted on. It's got the Coliseum video review guidebook.
Yep.
It's pretty thick, actually. It's pretty extensive. Like, I spent quite a while reading it, and I'm not that far into it. And also, just before Christmas, I went on a little splurge and bought a pile of wrestling books. You know, the National Wrestling Alliance one, the Wrestling Hall of Fame books. You know, the tag teams, the heels, the ones by Greg okay. Oliver. So I've been reading some of those as well. So it's pretty, pretty good stuff. But yeah, good Christmas. And
is that the NWA book, is that the one by, I'm trying to think of his name, Tim Hornbaker, maybe?
It is that one, yeah.
Have you read any of that? Because I know, based on what I've heard before, like, that book kind of fascinates me, because I really like oral histories in literature, but I know a lot of people say it's kind of dense.
Well, I haven't started reading it yet. And of all of the books I've got, it's the one that's slightly off-putting when you look at it. It looks like a proper tome, you know. So I've just been, the other ones are much easier to dip in and out of. But this one is it's a story from start to finish. And I think it's sold on this idea that the NWA was a little like a kind of, a bit like the mafia. That they had basically all of pro wrestling on lockdown. And it's telling that story. So I haven't had a look at it yet, but I will get around to reading it at some point. Probably in that long, distant time when I'll get around to watching TNT and all the other things that I say I'm going to do. Just before we start today, at the start of the last show, I said, give us some comments. Let me know you know, that you're listening to the show. And we got quite a few, there are quite a few comments. So I thought we'd deal with these just as we start off. Now, I know, Chad, that you have an aversion to this, right? You don't like listening to shows when they excessively talk about listeners' comments, right?
Yeah, I mean, I just think sometimes, I know there's some shows where it just seems like the comments kind of take up at least 25% to 30% of the show, yeah. And especially just personally in the review of the show, it either seems like it's a lot of the same stuff repeated, yeah. Or that's kind of the time where I zone out. So that's just a personal opinion.
So I'm going to just kind of give a couple of things here, especially if people have got something different to say. Okay, so let me quickly have a look. Well, this is from Biggest of the Bubbas. He sent this. He said, "I discovered this listening to the Clash Cast with Jason Mann through the Wrestlespective. So good job, we did the joint show there." And he said this is a good idea because WCW doesn't get enough love. And then he asks a couple of questions about where we get the footage. Thanks from that Biggest of the Bubbas. And I mainly read that out because I think that's a direct. He's having a go at you there, Chad, because you have the big Bubba connection. Then we have one from Mike R, saying that he's been listening to the show for quite some time, and he found it through the F4W online message board. You must have posted that, Chad, because I've never been on there.
Yeah, that's the Wrestling Observer message board. Which when we first started up, I had my subscription. My subscription has lagged to the Observer, but I'm thinking about re-upping, so I'll probably be posting in there that thread again.
So Mike R has a note about a Clash 2 show about Lyle Alzado. He says that Alzado was a very, very good defensive player, maybe not a Hall of Fame level player, but just below it. And he was one of the first American athletes to admit to using steroids and blamed the brain tumor that led to his death on heavy steroid use. So a bit of background on Lyle Alzado there. And we have, hold on a second, our old mates Edison Cheapy, also known as, what's his name? James Fabiano.
Right.
He's been catching up on some of our previous shows, and he's just listened through the Clash 1 show. And he has a bit of information about Nikita Koloff here. He says that his wife died in 1989. So obviously he'd stick around through 88. And he had a reunion with himself and Ivan as Faces. Then he left and Junkyard Dog team with Ivan at Starcade. So a little bit of spoilers here. He says his timeline is a bit off from Andy and Nikita's history. He just followed it from the Aptamags. But she could have taken a turn for the worse near the end of 88, which is why Nikita left. So I think we were speculating around on the with me and Jason were saying that it was around this time that Nikita lost his wife, so it could account for the fact that he goes pretty shitty. But that it didn't actually happen until a bit later, so it doesn't quite account for the steep downturn in his work. He does say that he turns up in AWA for a while in 89, and that's all he says there. And then what else do we have? And then on the PWO wrestling boards, which I'm aware for an absolute newcomer, maybe it's not the easiest of communities to crack. Chair, would you say that's true?
I would just say that for the pro wrestling only message board, it's kind of the type of thing where you're going to hear some opinions there that even on a message board like the Wrestling Observer message board, most people on the Wrestling Observer message board think that both Shawn Michaels and Kurt Angle are two great wrestlers, for example. On the pro wrestling only message board, certainly in regards to Angle, that opinion won't prevail. And Michaels is, most people, I would say, on that message board see Michaels' peak as his tag team days, actually.
Yeah.
So there's just, but the one thing that I do respect on the Pro Wrestling Only message board, and it is my favorite message board, yeah, wrestling-wise, is the fact that they are able to break it down and give some examples of why they feel that way. I mean, and at the end of the day, you may just have to say, I like this, you like that, but they are providing examples. They're not just saying, you know, Angle sucks or Shawn Michaels sucks to kind of be a contrarian internet wrestling fan. They are giving examples of why they feel that way.
People always give their reasons, but it's one board where basically if you're not going to put the work in, if you're not prepared to write, you know, a 500 word post explaining exactly what you're talking about, it can be a little bit difficult. And I noticed our buddy Solomon got into a bit of a back and forth about Bruiser Brody recently. You know, there's this long thread about whether Bruiser Brody's any good, and the standard consensus on Pro Wrestling Only, probably unlike, I'd say, you know, 80% of old school wrestling boards out there, is that Brody sucked, right? Most people think that Brody wasn't very good. And I think the received opinion from fans back in the day is that, you know, Brody was kind of a legend, you know, on par with a Stan Hansen or something. So it's difficult when somebody comes with a set of received opinions, and, you know, you've got to be prepared for those sort of views to be questioned. Anyway, these are the comments from Pro Wrestling Only. Shu was talking about our Clash show, and he was basically complaining that we talked too much about the commercials, which was pretty much my fault. So then there's a little bit of talk about whether we should talk about commercials or not. Solomon actually crops up with a comment himself. And he says, regarding Lyle Alzado, he was pretty much a household name in the late 70s and mid-80s as a DTDE, what's that, defensive DTDE? Any idea?
Probably defensive end. Let me look at that.
For the Orange Crush defense of the Denver Broncos. They went to the Super Bowl 12 against Dallas. He also played for the cardiac Brian Sipe-led Cleveland Browns. Solomon might as well be talking Dutch here, for all this makes sense to me. Then they went to the playoffs in 1980. He was on the Super Bowl champion Los Angeles Raiders team of 83, and he was known for having a real short temper and playing with a vicious mean streak. He had some incidents off the field with where his tempers revealed himself. And he later admitted to steroid use and ended up getting brain cancer after his career was over. He blamed the steroids for the cancer, and he even had a famous appearance on the Arsenio Hall show where he was all shriveled up and talked about his steroid use, and he ended up dying shortly after. So I think that's corroborating what Fabiano was saying. There's a lot more talk, but I'm kind of with you here, Chad, that, you know, we don't want comments to go on for 20 minutes or so. But yeah, I keep on letting us know what you know of the show, and maybe I'll pick out some things to read out.
Right, and just real quickly, that is defensive tackle, defensive end, which is the position he played. Which I don't know if you've ever seen American football, but if on the defense, that would be usually the people that on the defensive side will be the ones closest to the ball before it's hiked, or your defensive ends.
They're the big guys at the front who beat people up, right?
Yes. Yeah. They will go against the offensive line, try to sack the quarterback, some of them.
Yeah, the last thing I'll say about comments, you did say on there that you that last week you basically made a little mistake about the Rock and Roll Express and the Midnights having a match on this show, and it's actually, as we'll see, the Fantastics, who have a match against the Midnight Express. And I also, as we were going out, I said we'd have some special guests on for the Great American Bash Show, but those special guests will actually be doing the Starcade show, which was a decision that we took between now and then. Okay, so let's get on. Great American Bash 88. Looking forward to this one. I've been looking at the wrestling observers from around this time, and there are some kind of major news pieces that happen. So I thought we'd go through these before we get to the Bash show. The big piece of news, this is from the June 27th newsletter, is that the Powers of Pain have jumped ship to the WWF. Now, can you take a guess, Chad, about why the Powers of Pain jumped ship at this point?
I actually have no idea. I'm kind of curious now.
The story is that they wanted out before they had to work some scaffold matches with the Road Warriors. They were scheduled to have about a dozen scaffold matches with the Road Warriors in the autumn, in the fall, basically. That was the reason they gave, that they, you know, the Warlord, being 325 pounds, didn't want to take the bump. So they left. So there we are. That's a really bizarre reason, I think, for leaving.
Pretty bizarre, but actually makes more sense than kind of some of the reasons that were racing through my head when you asked that.
Yeah, and he talks about how it's a bit weird that the WF are going to use them as faces. Yeah, and I have to say, I think the double heel turn involving Mr. Fuji is one of the most confusing heel turns. I think it's from Survivor Series 88, off the top of my head. And that's one of my least favorite turns. I think it's Demolition and Powers of Pain. Demolition turn face and Powers of Pain turn heel, with the involvement of Fuji. On air, Paul Jones and the Road Warriors used the Heat Was Too Hot line, explaining where the Powers of Pain left, and effectively buried them on air, which is often what was done. You know, when somebody just kind of leaves suddenly, they always say, well, you know, this is basically where the big boys play, and they were scared and ran off. So they were going to be replaced. Their kind of space on the car was going to be replaced by a new tag team, the New Russians, which is Ivan Koloff with yet another partner, the Russian Assassin, who apparently is a guy called Angel of Death, Dave Sheldon. Any experience of watching him before?
I've watched him a little bit. He kind of came in 86, 87 UWF. He kind of came in as a member of Skandar Akbar's group there. Not very favorable opinions of what I remembered from him.
Yeah, well, he just seemed like a big guy in a mask on this show. He also says that Crockett have cleared 9.4 million homes for the Great American Bash show. Meltzer says that with the interest in Ric Flair versus Lex Luger very high, this should be a success, especially as it's running unopposed by the WWF. He says about 2.6 million people saw the main event from the Clash 2 show. And that Braves versus Giants game that we mentioned only got 1.5 million viewers, so wrestling was actually outdrawing Braves versus Giants. What's that? Football, right?
Baseball.
Baseball. Yeah. So wrestling's outdrawing baseball in July, June 88. Then from the July 4th newsletter, he says that the sale of NWA to Turner has become a distinct possibility, that the deal should be finalized by the end of July. The only problem is that David Crockett has been an obstacle, and both he and Francis have reservations, but Jim Crockett Jr. is basically pushing ahead with the sale. And he says that the Great American Bash 88 should easily be the biggest money non-WWF wrestling card in history. He says fans are convinced that this is the end for Ric Flair, which is the major selling point. Talking about Wrestling Observer subscriptions, he mentions here that it's time for renewal, and that it's $5 for 4 issues, $10 for 8, $20 for 16, $30 for 24, and $50 for 40. I think $5 for 4 issues is pretty steep in 1988. It's quite a lot of money. How much is the Observer nowadays?
Well, it's I have just the online portion, mm-hmm. So it's about $10.99 a month for the. I mainly read the Observer and the podcast when I subscribe to it.
Yeah.
Stuff was pretty expensive there. I guess around that time. I guess maybe the postage and handling and the work being done.
Yeah.
That's kind of one of them things that hasn't. The price hasn't inflated with time. It may have actually, it probably has deflated.
Yeah.
The equivalent of it.
His running costs are probably cheaper now than they were back in 1988.
Sure.
So, July 11th newsletter, Adrian Adonis died in that infamous car crash around this time. So we have a bit of an obituary for him there. He says that Great American Bash 88 should be the fourth biggest money card in history behind WrestleMania 3 and 4 and Survivor Series 87. Over 10 million homes are cleared now to watch Great American Bash 88. He also says the Bash draw drew well. Several shows made over $100,000 with the gate. And more update on about the sale to Turner. It's been put on ice now because David Crockett is against the sale. Also, there's a bit of behind-the-scenes machinations here with Ole Anderson trying to become a key player in the deal, either by breaking away and forming a new company with David Crockett or making a deal with Turner himself, which would mean that he didn't need to make a deal with Crockett. Obviously, neither of those things happened. July 18th, what happens here? This is actually the show where he reviews the Great American Bash cards. We'll get onto that later. But I'll just mention the actual buy rates before we start. From the July 25th newsletter, this is actually right when Bruiser Brody was killed in Puerto Rico. So a huge amount of this and the next newsletter are devoted to Brody. But he said there's conflicting reports on how well Great American Bash did pay-per-view-wise. It's either a 1.9 or a 4% buy rate. He says that it drew 4s and 5s in traditional Crockett markets, Georgia, Florida, Texas, kind of old Mid-South region, for example, but only 1s down the West Coast, which would be disappointing. The maximum it could have made is $6 million, the minimum $3 million. And he says $6 million would be really good, $3 million would be really bad. And then in the next newsletter, the August the 1st one, he clarifies that it was actually around $6 million that they made, which is about 400 buys. Works out as 4% nationwide, which means that all carriers will now take Starcade, which is obviously good news. So this show was a success for Crockett. But he does break it down. He says that even though they drew really well in the Carolinas and the Southeast, where they even beat WrestleMania, they drew badly in LA, 1.5%, and in New York they were only 2.2%. But that's kind of what you would expect, I think. The reason I wanted to go through that is that I think it shows that, you know, Crockett wasn't in dire straits around the time this Turner deal was happening. I think the wisdom is that, you know, it'd been run into the ground and Turner bought the company when it was on its knees. I don't think, like, from reading this, that doesn't seem to be the case to me, Chad. You're the accountant. What do you think?
Yeah, I agree with that. I don't know. I mean, yeah, the buy rates seemed to be kind of par of the course of what you would expect. So.
Yeah, I mean, it's not like they were losing money hand over fist, like WCW in '92 or something like that.
Right. Even business-wise, from 1990, why I've really liked the in-ring product from what I've seen. The gates at the houses just weren't doing very good business at all. So I would say even then, now in '88, they were doing better business overall.
So let's get on to the actual show then. We're in the Baltimore Arena. It's July the 10th that this show happened. Great American Bash 88, The Price for Freedom. So they were still doing the tour, but this is they decided that this year they were just going to feature one show. It was going to be one big pay-per-view show, and it was this one from Baltimore. Naturally, ring announcer is Gary Michael Capetta, because, as we know, Tom Miller doesn't go outside of Greensboro. I watched the WF 24/7 version, and from what I understand, the VHS version of this is heavily clipped down. I saw the reviews of Matt Petticord, our buddy there at PDR Wrestling, and also I had a look at an old Scott Keith review, and they clearly did the VHS version, and apparently that's really badly clipped. So if you are going to watch the show, make sure you watch the full version, because there's a couple of matches here that you really need to see in full. Our first match is Sting and Nikita Koloff versus Arn and Tully for the world tag titles. Our commentators are Jim Ross and Tony Schiavone. So as we start off here, the faces obviously have their shine sequence. Sting rolls Tully up for an early two count. We get a drop kick. Arn is kind of walking outside, and Sting does a flying body press over the top rope onto Arn on the outside, which is a pretty, pretty good spot. Nikita Koloff comes in and works on Arn's arm. Ross, throughout this, praises the Horsemen for their positive attitude, and he talks about how J.J. Dillon has instilled this attitude in them. he also talks about how there was a closed-door breakfast meeting this morning where all four Horsemen, who were defending each of their titles, had a meeting to discuss strategy. I wonder what was actually discussed at that meeting, if it took place. Nikita Koloff nails Arn with a sickle, and he gets Tully with a sickle as well. That gets a two count. Arn gets a foot on the rope. Sting comes in. Arn turns the momentum with a knee to Sting's gut and a sleeper hold. Schiavone notes that he's never seen Arn do a sleeper before. Sting gets back on top. He drop kicks both of the heels. Tully comes in. Takes a pair of arm drags. Nikita comes back in and works on Tully's arm. We get a series of near falls. Sting comes back in. The Horsemen can't seem to really get any offense going at all in this match. It's been all the faces so far. I've just got a note here that this is some pretty shitty arm work from Nikita Koloff. It's really bad. Sting's isn't much better either. I think it's quite odd to see a heel in peril segment go on for this long in a Crockett tag match. We get a hot tag to Arn, and things slow down a bit. We get a leg takedown by Nikita, half Nelson on Arn, then a full Nelson. Arn kicks Nikita in the knee, which is really your transition about 15 minutes in. He tags Tully in, who targets that knee, but Nikita comes back with a sickle over the top rope, that's no DQ. We're told that the momentum takes Tully over. we get that a few times tonight, where whenever the getting over the top rope spot that isn't a DQ, it's called momentum. I've never quite understood what they mean exactly. We get a suplex back in from Nikita. The count is broken by Dillon. Nikita Koloff goes after him and blows his shoulder on the post. Arn picks him up and rams him back into the post. We get a pump handle slam by Arn, which is an old Ole Anderson move. Jim Ross is really talking up Arn on commentary as being tougher than Gene Anderson. We get a hammerlock from Arn. Nikita is doing some really stupid shit psych-up moves at this point. He's poking out his tongue and making all sorts of noises. Arn nails the DDT for a two count. Tully comes in, he targets the injured arm, tags in and out now, but Nikita gets the knees up as Arn comes from the second rope. We get a hot tag to Sting, who gorilla presses Tully. He gets a bulldog on Arn. We get an atomic drop and a drop kick on Tully. A sleeper on Arn now from Sting. Arn tags Tully in, who goes for a sunset flip from the top rope, but is blocked. There's 30 seconds left in this match. We get a stinger splash on Tully, Scorpion Deathlock, as the time limit draw comes, and the faces think that they've won the belts. Now, I didn't like this match much, but Chad, what do you think?
I really like this match.
All right.
I think this one is kind of lost classic, because I do think most people have seen the clip version. It's a match that does have a lot of problems. The heel in peril sequence does go on for a long while.
Mm-hmm.
But I thought the arm work was a lot better than you gave it credit for. I mean, I think definitely in this match, Nikita is the worst person by far.
Yeah.
It's pretty obvious to me that Nikita has the least heat and has the worst work. But even in the arm sequences, you know, he did do some things to keep it going along, like trying to pin. I know there's a sequence where he's trying to pin Tully to the mat, and Tully has to keep kind of bridging out of it. And it looks like a pretty good grapple, actually, and shows a lot of struggle. So I think I did like that section a lot more. I thought the splash from Sting in the early going was just an incredible spot. The crowd was going nuts. The crowd was really hot throughout this mm-hmm. whole match.
Yeah.
And then when Nikita got his arm posted up against the guardrail, that created a good sense of heat, and the horsemen were able to kind of do their thing and work him over a little bit, which led to the hot finish. I thought the finish was hot. The actual finish result
mm-hmm.
Was stupid, but that's kind of a reoccurring theme that we'll see tonight. But as an overall match, I thought this was really good.
Oh dear! I think this is the first time we have a real disagreement on our hands, Chad. Because I didn't like this match at all. I thought Nikita sucked hard, like really hard. The heels got too little in. I thought the heel in the peril segment went on way too long and was basically a waste of time in the context of the overall match. The stretch sequence on Nikita was too short. And all in all, I just think Nikita did enough to bring this match down for me. I really, like, from all the bad Nikita performances we've seen, this is the one where he annoyed me the most, because he was just like, I don't know, I didn't like anything he did in this match, and when he was sticking his tongue out and shouting, and I don't know, I just hated him. I will say that Sting was pretty over, and that he, obviously, everything that he did in the match was quite good, but there was just too much, that kind of heel in peril segment goes on seemingly forever. Like, I was actively bored during some of that arm work. So yeah. We're gonna have to...
Yeah, I mean, I think definitely it's a match where I can definitely, somebody like yourself that really loves heels and the way heels work and like their dominating sections.
Yeah.
I think that's why a long heel in peril segment could be off-putting to someone like yourself.
Yeah.
And I'll freely admit that I would at best call Nikita adequate in this match. And I did have a lot of problem with the... It kind of reminded me of the Final Conflict match.
Yeah.
I don't know if you remember how long that heel in peril segment was. That was kind of what we got here, but... I don't know. I mean, that match was over 30 minutes. This was a 20-minute draw. So that seemed to help it a little bit.
Yeah, but I mean, in the final conflict, there was kind of a reason. You know, I think it's Donka Knodel takes the brunt of that beating. But there's a kind of feeling in that match that by the end, both teams are completely, you know, they've been through an actual war. Whereas here, the... Like, I don't think that the heel in peril segment actually contributed anything to the match. Like, we don't really, you know, I mean, I guess the story here is that the Sting and Nikita have got the champion's number, and that if this match had gone, you know, 31 minutes, they would have won the belts. I guess that's what they were trying to say. But for my liking, I'd like the heels to get, especially as Jim Ross on commentary is really putting over Arn and Tully is one of the great teams at this point. I think they needed to get more in within the 20 minutes. It was 20 minutes, not 30.
Right.
They needed to get more in to get that over, that this is actually a really good team. Because from my point of view, the faces were just, they just dominated this match. And like I've said before, I don't think Nikita or Sting at this point have got enough to do when they're on top to keep things going. But I'll agree to differ with you on this one.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not going to peg it as a like an all-time classic match, but as far as the match that I think is very interesting from a structure standpoint, I thought it definitely made Sting look like a star. I mean, besides the finish, again, I think the finish is stupid, and that is where Nikita annoyed me the most, actually, when he grabs the belt and raises his hand like he can't understand what Gary Michael Capetta just announced, that it was a time limit draw.
Yeah.
That does not do anybody any favors with that, but like I said before, that's kind of a reoccurring theme. But and we'd also be kind of remiss to not kind of give a eulogy of sorts to Arn and Tully, because this is the last time as a team we will see them.
Really? They don't have any matches on the upcoming clashes?
No, I don't believe so. And actually, in fact, I don't think Tully has a appearance period until Slamboree 94.
Oh my god.
This is the end of the road.
Do you know, that's just hit me. I wasn't expecting it to come this early. I can't believe it.
Yeah, because they were already out. I know they were already in, had left before Clash of the Champions 4. And I'm almost positive they don't have a match on Clash of the Champions 3. Let me give a quick look. No, they don't.
Oh my God. This is it.
This is it for Tully until 1994, where he makes a cameo. But this is really it as far as discussing him as a worker for us. And so I know at the end of 89, we talked about doing kind of a decade worker in review from the shows we've seen, and kind of an awards list. And Tully, I think for me, will be in the contention for a wrestler of the year. He'll be in the conversation for that.
No,
wrestler of the decade, excuse me. We saw him through these tapes, I think, have some great tag work and some great singles work.
I picked out Arn for MVP on the last three shows, and it seemed for a period there that we picked Tully out as the MVP for something like five shows straight. You know, he definitely still has the most MVPs of any worker. I think this is going to be a tremendous loss, not only for JCP but for us in this podcast, because this is right at the moment where Arn and Tully have probably become my favorite team, period, of anyone. So it's a shame that we're not going to get to see them.
It's kind of amazing. I will say that knowing what I know about NWA and WCW coming up, it's kind of amazing, really, that their tag division didn't take a huge dip. I think in a lot of ways they kind of added with quantity, not quality. I mean, I don't think there's a team besides the Midnight Express that's as good as Arn and Tully. But especially in 1990, you could plug in kind of, you know, Midnight's Rock and Roll Express, Pillman and Tom Zink, Doom, even the Steiners. You could plug in, they had about six or seven teams. The Freebirds, if they were motivated. You had all these teams that you could kind of fill out a card with effectively. So the division doesn't kind of totally get washed away, but I don't think, again, besides the Midnights, you see a team as effective as Arn and Tully. And I'm kind of struggling to think of a team that really feels that effective, period. Maybe when we get to the Dangerous Alliance, but that was such a short-lived kind of staple.
Yeah, well, Arn has a series of partners through the 90s, doesn't he?
Yeah, I mean, he's teamed up with Sabisco, which I know they have a pretty good run, and then him and Eaton in the Dangerous Alliance, but I don't think you really feel like a... I mean, I think definitely the Horsemen, Arn and Tully faction, they really feel like a semi-main event or a third from the top villain type team.
Yeah.
And I just don't know if you have a long... It'll be interesting to see. It's kind of something we'll have to wait and see. But definitely sad to see them go.
Yeah, and it's happened a lot earlier than I was expecting, actually. That's the thing that surprised me most. The next match now, speaking of tag teams, is the Midnight Express versus the Fantastics, who are the US champs at this point. And the stipulation with this match is that Jim Cornette is going to be in a straitjacket, in a cage, hanging over the ring. As this match starts, Jim Cornette gets on the mic and he says, "Everybody in this arena knows that I'm not crazy." And then Stan Lane gets on the mic, and he says, "He's the man who sold Mike Tyson his first workout video, Mr. James E. Cornette." And Stan Lane actually has quite an interesting voice. I haven't heard him on the mic before, but he's got quite a cool voice. The Fantastics enter now, and they're pretty... I said here that they're pretty over with the crowd, but we'll get more on that later, I think. Cornette struggles getting into the straitjacket, and he screams at the ref. It's quite a funny exchange, and at one point he says, "Can you be bribed?" And he offers him $5,000. The ref says he wouldn't take $10,000, and then Cornette offers him $15,000. Cornette says that he's a crackpot for being an honest man. Cornette says that he wants to cry, and starts having a tantrum, and members of the crowd scream at him, "Mama's little baby," and that then he finally goes into the cage. So as the match starts, so that was all fairly entertaining. As the match starts, we get Fulton and Eaton. Fulton gets the better of it. Lane comes in with a series of kicks on Fulton. He comes back by throwing him out of the ring. We get a baseball slide from Fulton, which is pretty cool. Tommy Rogers comes in. We get two drop kicks on Lane. Eaton comes in and takes a hip toss. Rogers is kind of generally on top now, and he ends up getting a one count. Ross talks about he starts talking about the Maryland Athletic State Commission board. And he says that several of them are in the crowd, this board of governors. And at that point, I was just thinking, this is kind of random, but they do come in, they do come to be significant later on. We had a series of double steam spots now, and the Fantastics are on top. The Midnights regain advantage with a sneaky bulldog from Eaton. Lane gets some powerful kicks in, and then a big clothesline. And Lane's kicks are pretty cool, I have to say. Eaton with a nice elbow. We get a neck breaker from him. Tommy Rogers comes in, and he's in real trouble, basically, at this point. He's taking a lot of offense. We get three more cool-looking kicks from Lane, and then he sends Rogers into an awesome backbreaker from Eaton. And I really like that. You get these three kind of kicks from Lane, and sends Rogers staggering into Eaton, who then gives a kind of swinging neck backbreaker. And I thought that was a great bit of double teaming. They've cut this ring in half now. We get the 360 backbreaker from Eaton now, an arm drop by him, which Jim Ross says is known as the divorce court. Did I hear him right there? The divorce court.
Yeah, that's they kind of typically call that. I don't know what the origin of that movie is. I guess you're divorcing the shoulder bone from the rest of the arm, but it just sounds odd.
We get a hammerlock from Eaton now. Rogers comes back by driving Eaton's head into the mat, but it's just a hope spot. Lane comes in. He kicks Fulton for good measure, and then we get a flashy sort of pin for two. Abdominal stretch, and then he shoves Rogers out to the outside. What happens now? Rogers manages to basically post Eaton while he's outside. We get a headbutt from Lane. Rogers fights back. We get a sunset flip for two. Eaton gets a slam and then hits the Alabama slam from the top rope, which is basically a leg drop from the top rope if you've never seen it before. Lane comes in. Fulton breaks the count. We get another abdominal stretch, a Russian leg sweep, rocket launcher, which is basically where Lane throws Eaton from the top rope onto the opponent. Rogers gets his knees up. We get a hot tag to Fulton. And I thought that the crowd was oddly muted for this hot tag. They didn't really come alive when Fulton came in, which surprised me a little bit. Lane manages to power slam Fulton. Coming through the ropes onto the concrete outside, which was a pretty impressive spot. Meanwhile, Tommy Young takes a bump from a crossbody by Rogers. Lane sneaks a chain to Eaton, which he wraps around his fist. He nails Fulton with it, and that's the three. And the crowd erupts. Baltimore seemed pretty down on the Fantastics, I thought. And they were I don't know if they were behind the Midnight Express, but maybe they were happy to see a title switch. At some point, Eaton sneaks the chain into Fulton's tights, which I thought was pretty cool. So I thought this was a good match. Before we get to your comments, Chad, I'll mention that Cornette comes down, but he's still in the jacket. The Fantastics grab him, and they get Tommy Young's belt and whip him, basically. And then we get a kind of messy bit with Bob Caudle. But yeah, what did you think of this one?
I like this a lot also. I have this above the first match.
Yeah.
I mean, for me, it's kind of pretty minimal, but I do like this match better than the first match. I think there's a lot of really neat little touches that consume this match that make it work. And honestly, a lot of it's from the Midnight Express side. I thought the Fantastics were not bad in this match, but Stan Lane, I thought this was one of his better performances, because
definitely,
the little jumping straight boot he gives to Fulton in the early going was really nicely done. Always love the Midnight Express. They did this kind of gimmick match a couple of times where Cornette was in a cage over ringside, and one thing that's really awesome that the Midnights do is in the beginning, when the Shine segment's happening, they always kind of go outside and look really disoriented and kind of off their game. And they portray that here. There's one sequence where they regroup outside and look up at Cornette for instruction. And that really gets over, I think, the importance of Cornette as a manager. And it's just really smart. I thought the work that the Midnights did in the Face of Peril segment was really good. The Alabama Jam looked really great. And then the finish was actually very intricate. It wasn't just kind of a chain coming out of nowhere for the pin, because you had the ref bump. And then I can't remember who first used the chain, but I think Lane was going to first use the chain onto Tommy Rogers, but they ended up going outside. They sort of teased the chain being used a couple of times before Eaton was able to hit Fulton with it, which Fulton was still on the outside selling the power slam. to the floor, so you kind of forgot about him, and then all of a sudden he comes back in the picture. He gets nailed with the chain for the pin, and then Eaton stuffs it in his tights again, like you said, which was very kind of genius.
Yeah.
So this match had a lot of kind of little touches like that.
The moment Fulton
really worked.
The moment Fulton finds that chain down his trunks is quite funny. He gives it like a funny look of shock and surprise, which made me laugh. I really like the Midnight. This is probably one of the better Midnight matches that we've seen in a while. Probably actually since Dennis Condrey was around. This is probably easily Stan Lane's best match that we've seen. And I thought some of their double teaming was very inventive during this match. And it was good. It was a match where we got to see the Midnight Express on top rather than being dominated, which is usually for the best. As has become clear as we've been going through these shows, I kind of like the Southern tag formula. I think it makes sense. I think it works. And oftentimes when matches deviate from that, as we saw with the first match, I don't like it unless there's a really good reason for it. So, yeah, no, I thought this match was good. And I should mention that Jim Ross kept on mentioning things like little details that had Jim Cornette had been there, you know, little mistakes that the Midnights make that wouldn't have happened, for example, or, you know, positioning in the ring. And I thought they did a good job of getting over Cornette's importance during the match as well.
Yeah, absolutely. Do you have Meltzer's star ratings for the show?
I do. Hold on. Give me one second. I think it's in the... Now, Meltzer's star ratings are quite interesting for this. He gives the first match 3.5 stars, and he gives this one 4 stars, which is about right, I think.
That's pretty close to where I would be with him.
I'd go 4 stars with this, and I'd probably go like 2 stars with the first match. So I'm quite a bit lower on it than you are. But you know, I'm not a fan of arm work at the best of times. So Nikita Koloff doing arm work is, you know. Anyway, we go from this to Tony and Jim Ross, and basically they're talking as various idiots make faces around them behind. Did you see that?
Yeah, there was a lot of mugging. Every once in a while, you'd see sort of the security guard kind of shrug people away and stuff like that. But there was definitely a lot of mugging for the camera when they would cut to them at ringside.
And these guys were Horseman fans because they kept on holding their 4 fingers out. So anyway, as we go from there, a massive triple-tiered cage is lowered onto the ring. And a ladder, a rather large ladder, is put on one side of this, so the guys can climb up to the top. Precious comes out, and she's got the key to the bottom cage. And this is the infamous Triple Tower of Doom match. The heels are the Varsity Club, Ivan Koloff, Al Perez, and a masked man, who is the aforementioned Russian assassin. The faces are the Road Warriors, Dr. Death Steve Williams, Ronnie Garvin, and Jimmy Garvin. So, as this match, they take quite a while to set up this ring, and we get to see them setting this up. And I thought maybe, why not throw to Bob Coddle in an interview at this point, or why not do something else? But obviously, they still these little things don't occur to the Crockett production. I thought this would be a perfect time, for example, for a promo from Flair or Luger, as this is being set up. Anyway, Tommy Young is the ref here, and he climbs the ladder in the most awkward, gangly manner imaginable. Did you see this? he looked really awkward climbing up that ladder.
Yeah, he was really delicate climbing the ladder. Yeah, he acted like it was going to collapse and fall at any time, which it made me nervous the way he gingerly was climbing up, because I was like, well, if he's having this much of a struggle, I can't imagine like when the Road Warriors or Dr. Death or some of these bigger guys get on the ladder. But I think it was just more of a case of Tommy Young being awkward, and I don't know if he's scared of heights or what, but he didn't look very comfortable doing that.
So the rules for this are kind of hazy. They do go through it. Basically, a horn will sound and the trap doors will open for 10 seconds. It starts off where two guys, it's a bit like war games, where two guys start off and then at intervals another two guys can come in. But at the same time, the trap doors open for 10 seconds, which gives a window of opportunity for somebody to make it down to the next ring. Down. And the aim is to get to the bottom and to leave out the door, which Precious has the key for. So this is... I was a bit hazy of those rules going into... I can only really say that after having watched it. I don't think they do a tremendous job of explaining the rules. Jim Ross says that Tommy Young needs some hazard pay for being involved with this match. Ronnie Garvin and Ivan Koloff climb the ladders to the top of the cage, and they fight in this little cage at the top. And this cage at the top is small. I think there's barely enough room for four people to stand in there. This is one of the more bizarre matches that we've seen, I think. Steve Williams and Mike Rotunda kind of wait to enter outside of the little cage at the top. We get some stiff shots back and forth between Ivan and Garvin. Then Williams and Rotunda enter as Garvin and Koloff try to go through the trapdoor. So the horn goes, Garvin and Koloff try to get through, and Williams and Rotunda kind of fight behind them. We get a shot of a girl in the crowd who looks absolutely baffled by this. She's got an look of utter bemusement on her face. The camera quickly pulls away from that girl. Garvin manages to get through the trapdoor. So he's on his own in that middle ring. But Koloff doesn't. So it's 2-on-1 in the top cage. Next thing that happens is that the horn goes so that Ronnie Garvin, makes it down to the bottom of the cage. So he's kind of on his own all the way down the bottom. As Steve Williams gets down to the middle cage, and so does Ivan Koloff. Precious lets Garvin out. And I've just written here, what the fuck is going on? So Garvin's left now. He's out of the match, which seems like a really anticlimactic way of... But he's made it down to the bottom, so he leaves. Now Ivan and Williams are kind of having a mini match in the middle cage. Animal, Al Perez, and Mike Rotunda are on the top cage. The trap door's open. Al Perez and Animal get down to the middle cage with the Russian Assassin, Rotunda, and Hawk up in the top cage. The horn blows again. I'm not calling all of the action here because it's very difficult to make out what's happening. The horn blows again. The trap door's open. Hawk gets to the middle cage. Al Perez and Animal make it to the bottom. Animal gets out. Al Perez gets out. I have no idea what's going on, to be honest. The top cage has Sullivan, Rotunda, and Jimmy Garvin in it. All of the rest of the guys who were left in the match are in the middle. The horn blows again. Ivan Koloff and the assassin get to the bottom. Why don't they? But they don't leave at this point. They kind of wait around. I've just written here, leave, don't wait for Hawk. But they do. They wait for Hawk. Predictably, they miss a double clothesline and Hawk gets both of them. I think the Russians should have just left. Now we have Williams and Rotunda in the middle cage. Hawk leaves. Williams punches Rotunda 8 times. Williams manages to get to the bottom and leaves. So we have Rotunda, Sullivan, and Jimmy Garvin in the middle cage. We get a double noggin knocker. The horn blows. Sullivan lies on Garvin as Rotunda slips down and out. So basically, it's just Kevin Sullivan and Jimmy Garvin at the end of this match now, and they're in the middle cage. Garvin stomps on Sullivan as a wild brawl erupts outside. So basically, all of the other guys are fighting outside now. Garvin works on Sullivan's leg. Both men get down to the bottom. Sullivan goes after Precious. Garvin gets 2 leg drops on Sullivan's leg, and then a brain buster, which is a move we don't see very often, unless you watch All Japan. Precious opens the opens the gate. Sullivan charges, but he's too late. Garvin gets out, so the faces win. Then Sullivan locks the cage, with Precious still inside there. He crawls towards Precious in a really sinister manner. She kicks at him. Sullivan has her leg. Hawk starts reclimbing the ladder. Then Garvin goes up as well. Sullivan grabs at her clothes, which is very rapey, I think. He starts choking Precious out now. Hawk makes it to the bottom, nails Sullivan. Garvin hugs Precious, and Sullivan is one sick bastard. So what do we make of all of this, Chad?
I thought this was way, way, way too long. way too long. I mean, and it's kind of one of them things where the three cages look pretty cool on your screen. When you see it set up, you're like, okay, this is a kind of interesting looking setup, but the match just doesn't work. Everything from the rules to the chaos of it. I mean, the good thing about War Games is it kind of builds to where everybody's in there, and then you get usually just a few minutes of kind of frantic action with everybody in there.
Yeah.
Here, there was just stuff going on all the time. In multiple cages, which made the camera, in order to get the whole match, the camera had to pan out to a real wide shot. So you really couldn't see anything. And another thing was the way to finish and win the match, kind of from a strategy standpoint, it didn't make a lot of sense. Like you said, there was a lot of times where people would go down to a lower level and then just stand around. Which, if the objective is to leave, you know, this is essentially a match where you're trying to flee. Why wouldn't you just kind of just go ahead and leave the cage and give your team a better chance of winning? So overall, I thought this was really long, boring, and I think you can see that because it's a concept they don't go back to the best of my knowledge, again.
I do believe there is one more kind of Tower of Doom match involving, in my mind, Hogan, Savage, and a pile of heels.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about. That's Uncensored 96.
Yeah.
That's a kind of weird match in that the cages are set up on the entrance, like where the entrance is.
Yeah.
That's where, I mean, I guess that's sort of the same structure, though, and that's one of the worst matches of all time. This wasn't as bad as that.
But Sullivan is involved. This is obviously Kevin Sullivan's idea, right?
Yeah, I don't know. Yeah, I guess I kind of wish whatever that parchment of paper or whatever that they kept presenting at Clash 2, somebody should just took that thing and burned it, because this is a concept of a match really sucked. And I don't know if Sullivan himself was booking this feud or what, but kind of, I mean, as a booker, he's always been someone that needs some editing.
Yeah.
And somebody should have just thought out this match at least a little better. But, I mean, this seemed kind of expensive to construct.
Yeah, and I do think that the match is saved, though, by the final sequence between Garvin, Sullivan, and the bit with Precious post-match. I think that gives that kind... I'm not going to say it was worth it to get to that point, but I can understand like the idea that this was all just a plan of Sullivan to get Precious alone in a cage.
I think that's the best sequence, especially when, like, Hawk climbs down and hammers Sullivan. They go to a shot of the crowd where the crowd's really into it. You see a lot of arms raised in the air. So that's definitely the best portion of the match, but yeah, we really didn't need 22 minutes to get there.
Yeah, and I have to say that Sullivan is particularly dark during that bit when he's crawling towards her and kind of grabbing at her clothes. It's kind of...
I really don't like Kevin Sullivan. He's really someone that even, I mean, obviously his Satan worshiping footage, that I think there's very little to none that's made tape of that, so I haven't seen any of that. But I just, he's someone that I've never been able to really get behind or take serious. I don't know what it is with him, maybe his framework. But even as like a deranged kind of sadistic character, I just never really buy it. So that's something that that I really struggle with.
One of the little comments that Meltzer makes here is that he criticizes Hawk, or he criticized the booking here. He says that really this was Jimmy Garvin's save to make, so why was Hawk involved in that bit?
That's kind of true. But Jimmy was kind of fresh on his heels too. But that's true as well.
He gives this 2 3/4. My feeling is that you might go 1 for this.
If that. I really did not like this match. I thought it was... I just think that in a show that's... I really like this show overall. I'll just say that now. Mm-hmm. I don't know if really like, but I like the show. But to me, this was kind of just the middle section that really dragged it to a halt. And with the action, I mean, I don't even know if I'd be comfortable rating the action, because again, with the long camera, you lost a lot of intensity with the brawling, and you didn't even really see how stiff a lot of the punches were because of the camera angles.
Yeah, but I will say, I mean, I don't think I'm quite as down on it as you are, because I just think as a spectacle, as a one-off, unusual match to see, I'm kind of glad I've seen it. The first half of it does drag. So anyway, we go from this to Bob Coddle, who's in the crowd, and he can't believe that match has just happened, and nor can I really. Now, I would have thought that we'd have a promo here, but it's just a pointless segment with Bob Coddle killing time, saying nothing at all of importance. It's really strange. So that they even thought to have a talky segment here as the cage is being set down. Why not give us a promo? So the next match here is Barry Windham, who's the US champion, versus Dusty Rhodes. Windham's with J.J. Dillon. Tony Schiavone calls this the biggest match of his career to date. And Ross reminds us that Dusty never lost the title. We get some terrible music dubbed over Dusty's entrance as we start out, and it's even more terrible than the usual kind of generic WWE music they stick in there. As they were making the announcements, I noticed that Dusty is now up to 289 pounds, so he's put on almost 20 pounds since the last time we've seen him, apparently.
In about a month, yeah.
Windham is in a kind of black leather number, where he's wearing a black leather jacket, some kind of black leather, what would you call those, leggings? They're not leggings, they're kind of like black leather all around his...
Chaps.
Yeah, chaps. And a black leather waistcoat. Kinky. So as this starts out, we get an arm drag from Rhodes, strong shoulder tackle, Windham bails. JR gives a bit of analysis here. He says that there are two factors in this match. First of all is the emotion, the fact that these are former best friends. And the second thing is that J.J. Dillon really hates Dusty Rhodes, and he's faced him many times as a manager, so he's got some tactics. He also mentions that Dusty is weighs more than Barry Windham, but the Windham's got youth on his side. So as we start this off, we get an elbow to the back of the head from Windham, a body slam and a DDT from the Dream, crossbody from the top rope by Dusty. Windham bails again. Dusty starts dancing now, and we get some jive jabs. Dillon gets on the apron and takes a tumble. We get 5 minutes call from Capetta at this point. We get some kicks from Windham to Dusty's midsection. The action goes outside. We get a shoulder into the railing. Windham goes for a pile driver outside, but obviously that's reversed into a backdrop. We get 6 or 7 punches now, I think, from Windham. another 5 in the turnbuckle. So it was kind of odd to see Heel do that turnbuckle punching spot. Things go back outside. I think, a toupee to the outside. A slam by Rhodes on the concrete. Dylan distracts Dusty for Wyndham to come back. He hits a slam, big elbow drop. He goes for the claw. Dusty fights, and I still don't really like this move, the claw. I know you like the claw. We get a series of near falls from this claw. Dusty might be blacking out here, and Tony mentions that this was how Ric Flair won the title from him two years ago in St. Louis, that he blacked out, which was a nice little callback from Tony. Dusty reaches down for some jive power, but it's just a hope spot. The claw remains on, and it's been on for a long time now. Dusty tries to get a third wind, and this just looks ridiculous to me. You know, this claw spot with Dusty kind of wriggling around trying to get a third wind. eventually we do get a bionic elbow. Wyndham goes straight back to the claw though. Dusty sits on the turnbuckle and slaps Wyndham. Wyndham then goes for a superplex, which is not happening. Tommy Young takes a bump. Dusty slams Wyndham from the top. We get a big elbow drop. 15 minutes have gone. And then out of nowhere, Ronnie Garvin comes down. And he's in a pair of jeans. And then out of nowhere, wow, he nails Dusty Rhodes. Lays him out with a right hand. Wyndham goes for the claw again. And this gets a 3 count. Dusty is out cold. I can't believe Ronnie Garvin. Unexpected heel turn here. Steve Williams is out to check on Dusty. Not bad at all, I thought, this match, but there was a lot of claw. What did you think?
I apologize for defending the claw on the last show, because this was some of the worst shit I've ever seen in regards to the claw. I actually timed it, and he was in the claw hole for about 5 minutes and 20 seconds, which is just absolutely insanely ridiculous. Dusty, if you had a problem with the way Nikita looked in his some of the submissions earlier, I can imagine what you thought about Dusty kind of juicing up here. Look completely stupid. And it's kind of a shame, because I did like the match up to that.
Yeah.
Pretty good. I mean, I thought, like, especially Wyndham was really working hard, I thought, tonight. And the bump he did where he was on the inside of the ring, Dusty was on the apron outside, and Dusty kind of flips him over to the concrete floor. I thought that was a great bump by Wyndham. But that claw kind of runs any hope of the match for me. I'd still say it was decent, but the claw went on way too long.
Yeah, and I mean, I don't know if you can. Dusty Rhodes' face during some of those spots where he's trying to get the jive power. I mean, it's almost like he's channeling soul singers or something. He's kind of doing like a voodoo magic face. It's bizarre. It really is strange.
Yeah, I think this is some of the weirdest, kind of the most weird facial expressions I can remember, where he kind of gradually gets up and starts dancing around. It just looks completely ridiculous. And somebody that's always been a pretty big Dusty fan, I was kind of embarrassed for him watching this, because I thought it looked awful.
Yeah. Well, Meltzer gives this one 1.25 stars.
Yeah, well, that's typical, because, I mean, he hates Dusty. I mean, I might do a little bit more just because the 12 minutes or whatever up to the claw were pretty good. But that claw hold, I mean, it would have been okay if it had only been like 2 minutes. But, I mean, talk about kind of a way to kind of kill a finisher, because this is Wyndham's new finisher and Dusty's in it for, like I said, 5 minutes. 5+ minutes, then it doesn't end the match. They still had to have Ronnie Garvin come out there and, I guess, take the bribe to end up winning the match.
Meltzer does mention here that when Garvin when Garvin does lay out Dusty, he reckons that most of the fans cheered. Did you hear that?
Yeah, I mean, this, I don't know. I really don't know what to say. I would say, kind of, if you want to watch the Tower of Doom as a spectacle, you should just go ahead and watch this match as a spectacle, too, because that whole claw sequence with the way Dusty acts, maybe kind of one of the most unintentionally funny wrestling things I've seen in a while, because it looked completely ridiculous.
What did you make of the Garvin heel turn?
I don't think, I'm kind of interested to read his history, because I'd kind of forgotten about it, and I don't think it really leads to much.
I think he's in WWF by early 89. At the latest. So, getting towards the end now for Garvin. I didn't really think that they needed to turn him at this point. He wasn't getting... didn't seem stale to me. I think his post-world title run is not bad, you know, tagging with Jimmy Garvin, and still reasonable, kind of mid-level face guy.
One thing that I thought was weird, I mean, I guess maybe we're going to talk about it with them in the backstage, but... I mean, they never really, I don't know, maybe they mentioned it in the TV or something, but that Garvin was hard on cash or what, but, I mean, he certainly looked giddy getting this suitcase of money from not only JJ, but Gary Hart was there somehow, which I don't know what connection he had, so I've kind of, I don't know if there's some blanks that can be filled in. From that, but that was just sort of a weird sequence.
Yeah, so we're taken to the back to the locker room, and Garvin's basically celebrating with J.J. Dillon and Gary Hart, and then he's seen carrying a big, massive suitcase of cash away, and with a kind of mega smile, a very sleazy smile on his face. So yeah, if anybody knows a bit more about that, let us know. This is if you were watching the TV around this time. So anyway, this leads us to the main event, Lex Luger versus Ric Flair for the world title. J.J. Dillon busy tonight. This is his third match. I note here that Flair is definitely booed by the crowd coming into this, and that Lex Luger is really over in Baltimore. As this match is starting, I am sure that I spot Dave Meltzer himself in the crowd with a horseman sign. I could be wrong, but it looked a lot like Meltzer. I don't know. Did you see Meltzer in the crowd?
I didn't notice that. I would hope not, but who knows?
As things start out, Luger overpowers Flair. We get an arm drag by Luger. Two big chops by Flair, which have no effect at all. Luger kind of laughs them off. We get a hip toss, a drop kick from Luger. Flair takes a tumble to the outside. Ross mentions that maybe for the first time, Luger's a college degree. He doesn't give the grade point average at this point. We get a gorilla slam from Luger. Flair falls outside and over the railings. He calls Tommy Young over, who then shoves him and then runs away and hides behind Lex Luger, which was kind of weird. This ongoing Flair-Tommy Young feud. Flair shouts at a guy in the crowd, and he says, you got a problem with that, fat boy? We get a test of strength, which is not something that Flair should be getting involved with Luger. Another gorilla slam, a bear hug. Ross praises Luger's game plan here, and Shivani mentions that Flair's old back injury is going to come into play from the plane crash. We get a suplex from the outside to the inside from Luger, a two count, very high elbow drop. Then he goes for it again, but misses. Flair hits chop outside, nails Luger on the railings, throat first. We get a snap mare, a knee drop, reverse knife edge, another snap mare, another knee drop, which gets a two count. We get a right hand into Luger's ribs, and he focuses on the rib cage for a bit now. Luger makes a semi comeback. With a flying clothesline, which doesn't quite connect. We get an uppercut by Flair. He goes to the top. Luger shakes the ropes, and Flair lands back first. No, sorry, he lands balls first on the top rope, which could hurt. Jim Ross says that can adjust your career. Luger misses a drop kick, and both men are down. We get another clothesline by Luger, which gets a two. Sunset Flip gets a two. Flair kicks Luger in the leg, and now works on it for the next few minutes. We get a figure four. Luger is in so much pain here that he's virtually doing sit-ups in the figure four. He's kind of convulsing back and forth. Flair uses ropes for leverage. Luger reverses the figure four, but Flair kind of breaks it pretty soon. He attacks Luger's leg again. Luger hits a clothesline over the top rope. Again, there's no DQ. It's momentum, we're told. We get a big chop, four of them, from Flair. Luger roars like a lion now and comes back. We get a third gorilla slam, but he misses a knee drop, which is called as a tactical error by Jim Ross. Flair goes up top, and he's caught and takes a fourth gorilla slam. We get eight punches in the corner and a big clothesline from Luger, which gets a two count, but it's broken because it's in the ropes. We get another 10 punches from Luger, and a flair flip to the outside. Ross says that his inexperience is showing here. We get a backslide for two. Both men go over the top rope, and Flair has hurt his leg. He yells out, "Ah, my leg." He posts Luger outside, gets a chair. Tommy Young comes out and convinces him to drop it. Dylan posts Luger again, who now has some colour. Not a lot of colour, it must be said, but he does have some. We get five punches now. Luger hulks up. We get a power slam. The crowd is wild. We get a torture rack, and the bell goes. Luger goes nuts and thinks he's won the title. We get all sorts of faces, including Sting and Steve Williams, hit the ring to celebrate with him. But we get an announcement from Gary Michael Cabetta that the State Athletic Commission of Maryland has intervened, and that they've thrown this match out because of the laceration to Luger's face. I think his name is James Iannucci, the State Athletic Commissioner of Maryland, and there's a massive bullshit chant from the Baltimore crowd. What do you think of this one, Chad?
I like the match a lot. I thought that kind of I'd like to commend Luger because in some ways, especially in the very beginning, like his strategy of kind of walking through Flair's offense, we've seen that a few times, probably most notably with Hawk at the Bunkhouse Stampede. But Luger was able to kind of throw in some type of kind of cold, determined emotion that made it not frustrating. And his strategy was sound in going after the back. Then the Flair section where he controls the action, I thought was really well done. Very brisk pace, and the selling from Luger was really good. Even when he was in the figure four, he sold the leg throughout the remainder of the match. So I thought this was a really good match, and then the finish, though, I think is maybe one of the worst, probably one of the worst finishes for a major show I can think of. It kind of had been discussed about the Maryland Athletic Commission, but just felt really cheap, really hollow. And if I was Luger, I'd be absolutely furiously pissed because, I mean, he'd been bleeding for a decent amount of time before they decided to call the match after he'd gotten Flair in the torture rack and everything else. And I don't know. I really didn't see where Luger bladed, but to me, it really should have been a lot more blood because to call it based on what we saw seemed made, you know, Luger kind of seem like a pansy too because it's like little trickle of blood. I mean, I probably had nosebleeds that had bled more than what Luger was bleeding here, and, you know, it cost him a chance to the championship.
Yeah, and also I thought it made the whole show seem kind of down on Marilyn. Do you know what I mean? It was almost like Jim Ross was complaining about, you know, Marilyn itself.
Yeah, which, I mean, that to me, I think that may be kind of more Ross kind of winking at the crowd or at the audience saying, you know, I recognize that this is a shitty finish.
Yeah.
So he's just kind of coming up with something to justify what they just saw, but I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, I thought it was a decent, probably one of the better Luger matches we've seen so far. I do think he's still young here, and he's on top for a significant portion of this match, and I think it's telling that he doesn't have a huge amount of stuff to do. You know, we see four different Gorilla Slams in this match, and part of that, I think, is because he doesn't have much more to do, if that makes sense. Like, his repertoire is not big enough at this point to carry a you know, a 20-minute match. That said, I do think that what we see is pretty good. You know, it's not a bad match at all. The structure-wise, it's not a typical Flair match, I think. I think there's... and Ross and Schiavone do quite a good job of talking about Luger's game plan and his strategy and the fact he used to be in the Horsemen, so, you know, he definitely knows how to approach Flair. And then maybe the inexperience line was slightly overused, that they kept on saying that he was, you know, his inexperience is showing through, because there's various times where he doesn't hook the leg or he hesitates before going for a pin or something like that. But I think as a general story, it kind of worked for the match. But obviously, you know, the finish is a bad finish. Meltzer actually argues that this was the time that maybe Flair should have dropped the title for a while. He's been the champion for a long time. And he actually says, I'd rate him as number three in the world behind Owen Hart and Ted DiBiase, which is kind of topical given our recent discussions on PWO. Nobody will deny that he's been a tremendous champion for the past 7 years, but now it's time to make a major change. And
That is... what a ridiculous statement to make. I mean, of the top three you throw out, just what I've seen of 88 All Japan and New Japan, for that matter, to throw out Owen Hart and DiBiase as your top two over what was going on elsewhere just seems asinine. But, I mean, I don't know. I mean, it kind of... To me, in some ways, it feels like they sort of booked themselves into a corner with this match because of all the talk and all that. I mean, I kind of don't know whether... I mean, it'd been interesting if they'd have pulled the trigger on Luger here, but I kind of do agree with what you're saying, that I don't know if he was quite ready. It's definitely, I think, a point of contention on whether he should have gotten the belt. I mean, I think there definitely should have been a better finish figured out, or else they shouldn't have booked the match in the way they did. But, I mean, I don't know if Luger was quite ready, because he did still show some weaknesses. But I thought, as far as putting together a big match, this was the best we've seen. Even though, again, he still had some flaws. I don't want to overly gush Luger, because in his comeback he did some punches in the corner that looked really weak.
Yeah.
Right before the finish, and then also, you know, he did sell his leg, I thought, really well during the match, but as soon as he wins or thinks he wins, he jumps about 12 feet in the air right on the leg.
Yeah, that's true.
Which was kind of disappointing to see, especially with how well he sold the leg work during the actual match. So, I mean, there's still flaws there. And I think it would have been maybe a breath of fresh air if he had won the title. But I don't, he's certainly not what you, I mean, you're so used to Flair kind of, I mean, I think really too, with the NWA, you have a mold of kind of a traveling, polished champion.
Yeah,
they can kind of go to different territories, work a match with anybody's top guy in the territories, and really represent the title well, and Luger is certainly not that type of person, even though, you know, now the by this time, the NWA was just, you know, their own kind of little entity, and he wouldn't be defending the title in other territories. It's still, it would have been a definite break in mindset from what they had traditionally had as a champion.
Yeah, I mean, my view on this is that if you were going to change the title at this point, probably the man that you should have looked to is Barry Windham, and not turn Windham when they did turn him. That means we wouldn't have got that version of the Horseman, but of the people on the roster, the only guy who could carry things on the face side work-wise was probably Windham, to do what a traditional NWA champ would have done. I don't see Lex Luger doing that. And this would have not only been, if they put the title on Luger, wouldn't have just been a lot for Luger to do at this point in his career. It would have been a major change in booking philosophy for them. I mean, they'd have had to book him like Hogan or something for it to work, which is something that Crockett had never done. He'd never had a champ like that. The other thing I thought I'd note is that this does kind of set a pattern for Luger's whole career, doesn't it? That he's kind of a choker when it comes to the... Like, he's really close to winning the title, but doesn't quite win it.
Yeah, this is the first... this is the first example of kind of that motif that really kind of, in some ways, haunts the rest of his career. I mean, we'll see a lot of his moments again, but I do think that, like, the way he'd been presented throughout his career made it so satisfactory, like the... like that Monday Nitro when he beats Hogan for the belt. I mean, that makes that moment so satisfactory because he had always choked in those positions before.
Yeah.
Of course, he loses it like 6 days later, but, you know, it kind of does. This does seem like the first sort of entry into the Luger choke kind of protocol that most fans remember of him.
Yeah, I do think he's one guy who's hurt by booking quite a lot. I mean, if he doesn't choke, he tends to have turns at the wrong moment, you know. So when we actually do see him win the world title, like, he kind of turns on the same night, so it's kind of tainted, you know. It's usually like the timing of things is... That night with Hogan is probably the only night where it all comes together for Luger in a big match scenario that I can think of, really. Usually there's some kind of booking question or some bullshit that hurts Luger. Let's do our end of show awards.
Sounds good.
Yeah, match of the night?
My match of the night, I am going to go with the main event. Let me think about this. I think I am going to go with, I am going to call an audible, and I'm going to switch at the last minute. I'm going to go with the Midnight Express and the Fantastics.
Yeah.
I like the main event a lot, but that finish, again, kind of talking it out with you, the finish really annoys me, I think, even more than when I watched it again. Mm-hmm. I mean, and the Flair Luger match is a match I've seen countless times, so I think I was kind of immune to the finish. I'd expected it, but if I'd have been watching that live, I'd have been pretty royally pissed. And in contrast, the Midnight Express and the Fantastics had a really clever finish, I thought. So, you know, the finish kind of edges that match for me, where I think the actual match structure, I may prefer the main event just slightly. But the finish of the Midnights match is a ton better than the main event, so I'm going to go with that.
Yeah, and we will see better Luger Flair matches in the future, I think.
Yeah, certainly the Wrestle War 1990 match is, I think, a truly great match, and I remember their Starrcade match being better than this one, too, so I'm interested to see if that holds up.
Yeah, same match of the night for me. It's the Midnight match. I think that's clearly the best match on this card. Like I said, we saw some innovative double teaming in that match, which I enjoyed. And the finish was really quite intricate as we went through. MVP.
Now my MVP, I am gonna go with Ric Flair because of I think the way he worked that match, he made Luger look effective. I think his offensive segment was one of the better championship Flair offensive segments we've seen. Kind of reminded me of the cage match with Jimmy Garvin where he really busted out a lot of stuff. He looked really focused tonight, and I thought he put in a really good performance.
Yeah, well, this is going to seem like I'm taking Flair for granted again, but I'm going to go, I think, with Bobby Eaton. I thought this was probably the, like we mentioned Stan Lane and that he had a good match. I think this is probably the best Bobby Eaton match we've seen as well. In terms of, you know, we got some, he was good at selling, like he did all the usual things that Bobby Eaton did, but we got some fleshier offense than normal from him as well. You know, the Alabama jam, the 360 backbreaker, the swinging neckbreaker he did, the other backbreaker. So, you know me, I kind of like big moves, and Bob Eaton gave us quite a few of them. So I'm going to go with Bob Eaton as my MVP for this show. So now we get to the Billy Graham Award, and I don't think there's any question who I'm going for, but who are you going for, Chad?
I'm probably going with somebody different. My winner is Dusty. I thought he looked awful in the claw. I thought the booking on this show beyond that was pretty awful in certain categories. The opening match and the main event, the show was kind of bookended by terrible finishes. So, you know, add in the selling on the claw to the booking, and Dusty's pretty much, honestly, my runaway choice for the award tonight.
So, I'm obviously going to go for Nikita Koloff because I thought that he sucked hard, really hard in that first match. And he didn't, like, for me, Dusty is redeemed slightly by the fact that his facials are entertaining and they made me laugh, whereas nothing that Nikita did make me, like, you know, he just annoyed me in everything that he did. So, Nikita Koloff for me, and I think that's, you know, third time probably that he's won the Billy Graham Award, which is as many times as Billy Graham himself won it. Now, just as we're closing off here, Meltzer basically mentions that of the past six major cards that Crockett have put out, which is basically the two Clash shows, Crockett Cup, Starrcade, this, and what would the other show be? The Bunkhouse Stampede. That he rates this as the third best one out of the six of them, behind Clash 1 and the Crockett Cup. The second night of the Crockett Cup he puts above this. Where would you rank it, do you think, off the top of your head?
Okay, what's the six shows again? You got both Clashes, Crockett Cup, Bunkhouse Stampede, this show, and what's the other one?
Starrcade 87.
I definitely have it behind Clash 1. Clash 1 to me is clearly the best show.
Yeah.
I'd probably, I think I would maybe have this as second, though, honestly. Even without the bad finishes. I mean, because to me, Starrcade 87 also had a pretty crappy finish in the Road Warriors match. And while the main event was more satisfactory in that show, I think overall, to me, this show had three good matches minimum at it. And when you're talking about a five-match card, that took up, that was probably, that was almost 60 to 70% of the show I thought was really good. And even the other stuff that I didn't think was good, the Tower of Doom kind of has a kind of appeal being a unique match. And the Dusty Window match was pretty good, just had a terrible ending sequence. So I'd probably rank this show second and Starcade 87 third. What about yourself?
I would go along with that. Yeah, I'd put it second as well. I actually really like this show. It doesn't have any classic, you know, there's no five-star classics on this show. But it's a pretty solid card. You know, there's five matches, and there's something of interest in each one of them. You know, the Tower of Doom for novelty alone is worth watching, at least once, I'd say. And, you know, I thought the stuff at the end with Kevin Sullivan was creepy as well. Yeah, there's three good matches, like you said. I think the Midnight's match is one of their better matches. I may even go higher than 4 stars if I had to rate it. And it's probably the best Lex Luger match to date, would you agree, from him in this run? The best major match that he's had. I think he shows with the shows that he can main event, basically.
Yeah, I mean, I think as an overall match, I definitely like the Clash 1 tag match better.
Oh, yeah, no.
But I mean, he obviously was asked to do a whole lot more in this match. So I would say this was probably maybe his best performance in some ways.
Yeah, and oh, don't forget that you had Arn, Tully, and Sting in that match as well.
So. Right. Wyndham, actually.
You're right, it was Wyndham. Wyndham. Arn and Tully. So in that case, I could probably have a decent match with those guys. I'm joking. Okay, well, I think we have Clash 3 next, and I'm looking forward to that, but I'm looking forward to it slightly less because there won't be any Arn or Tully. I'm sad about that. They're in the show, right? They just don't have a match together?
No, they're not in that show at all.
Oh, God.
Either one of them. I don't know when their last date was with Crockett when they left, but because I did think that I thought that Arn had a singles match, but when I just looked at the results, got Rotundo versus Brad Armstrong, Nikita and Steve Williams versus the Sheepherders. So I can't wait to hear your thoughts on that one. Dusty versus Kevin Sullivan, which I can't wait to hear my thoughts on that one. Ricky Morton and Ivan Koloff in a chain match, and then Sting and Barry Windham, and kind of that match I'm looking forward to rewatching because that's I've been really impressed with Sting. Also, I mean, I think he clearly looks like a big star in what we've seen on these shows.
Yeah.
So it'll be interesting to see him in kind of a long form singles match with Barry Windham, who, you know, he honestly, in some ways, I think he's been really cramped by these big shows and made my perception of him lower because he's a guy that a lot of people kind of talk about as an all timer. And besides, like, maybe the Crockett Cup 87 match with Flair. Which I think I was lower on than most, even though I still thought it was a great match. He hasn't had many matches or great performances, really. No. A lot of that's been his competition, but
I agree with you there, and I mean Barry Windham's one of those guys who I've seen quite a lot of him, and he's never really done it for me, you know. So I'm looking, like, as we get into 89. Seeing more, he leaves for a while, doesn't he? Goes to WF at some point.
Yeah. I mean, I think pretty much after probably Starcade, I think maybe his last bit. And I mean, I know before I've liked his 91, 92 tag team stuff probably the most in his series with Brian Pillman. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I've kind of been surprised at, I mean, even a match with Dusty was not a great worker, and I don't want to dog him on this show because I thought he was good here, but just in some of his matches we've seen, it felt like he's kind of just been there.
Yeah, so he's got it all to do before he leaves for WF, I think. Alright, Joe, well, thanks a lot, farewell for now, and farewell to Arn and Tully.
guess now it's time for me to give up. I think it's time. Got a picture of you beside me, but your lipstick mark still on your coffee cup. Oh yeah.
So we got MVP. Gotta be Tully, isn't it?
Yeah, I would say Tully.
So our MVP, Tully.
I would say Magnum and Tully together, because when you think Starrcade, you think that match.
Yeah, I would agree that. I mean, Tully was great. I sort of expect that from Tully in a lot of his big matches.
So MVP for the Great American Bash 86, Chad.
I feel like I say this every time. I think this is three times in a row where I went with him, but I'm gonna go with Tully.
It's hard not to give it to Tully, isn't it? Like, he seems to win it every time. MVP.
So I'm actually going with Tully, the old standby for MVP.
For all of us here at WCW Center Stage, for Cowboy Bill Watts and the American Dream Dusty Rhodes, I'm Jim Ross saying good night, everybody.